Penguin Random House Audio presents The Speckled Beauty, A Dog and His People. This is the author, Rick Bragg. For Sam. Who wants a perfect dog? Willie Morris. Introduction. Guilty as sin and one eye shining. The driveway is a winding quarter mile, a dim green tunnel through tangled pines and mountain pasture, fractured by dappled sunlight on the clear, hot days. Flashes of color, a blue jay's yellowhammers and an emerald blur of hummingbirds, crisscross the rusted barbed wire. And mockingbirds touched down on cedar posts that were cut from this mountain 100 years before. White-tailed deer and wild turkey, like periscopes, spy over tall, sharp blades of Johnson grass, and white egrets, rare here in the red dirt, up so high, pose on one leg in the flat, brown water of the pond. And it all seems painted on somehow, as if someone dreamed it up on a slow day with an easy mind and hung it on the air. Then he rumbles in and goes to raising all kinds of hell. The dog, running half-blind, tongue out and wide open, intercepts my truck halfway up the drive as the wild things scatter to the corners of the earth. He yowls, twists, and bounces to a hard stop right on some mark only he can find, usually smack dab in a red ant bed or a mud hole, but always safely away from the main road, as if he can remember all the meanness and suffering there, and knows this mountain is his sanctuary and his last stand. Run too far, and you fall off the world. I know this is reading a lot into a dog who falls asleep in his food bowl, suffers a shivering apoplexy when you rub his belly, and acts as if every wayward possum is a sign of the end of times. But I don't think any dog knows home better than one thrown away once already. This is, though, pretty much the sum of his comprehension. He seems to forget every waking day that a one-ton truck is not to be messed with, and, biting at the spinning tires, tries to herd it up the drive like a big, sparkly cow. He'll move, people say, because everyone is an expert when it's not their dog in the road. But I can never recall which side his bad eye is on. So I stomp the brake and twist the wheel and finally, lurching, cursing, arrive at the cabin at the top of the hill. I swing open the door, and the dog, 76 pounds of wet hair and poor decisions, lunges in, eternally surprised and overjoyed that it is me. I yell, "Get down," but too late. The truck's cab is tattooed in dirt, mud, or biting ants, because he needs to squirm to within an inch of my face to be sure. I might have been UPS, or the man from Cherokee Electric, who has learned to bring a stick. Then, with a growl, he is off to molest the livestock and stir a general panic. He is a herding dog by blood, an illegitimate Australian shepherd, and he bolts into the pasture to create a small stampede. He evades the thumping hooves by inches, but always gets caught up in a never-ending circle and cannot find his way out, like a drunk teenager doing donuts in a parking lot. I stumble after him, yelling, threatening. And he hunkers down and covers his eyes with his paws. I used to think he did it out of shame, but now I think he believes this makes him invisible. Recently, I came home from a week-long trip to find the driveway peaceful and empty, the terrible dog nowhere around. It always made me a little nervous when he didn't rush down to meet me. As much as any creature I've ever known, he has lived a blink away from destruction. My brother Sam was in the barn beating on an old Yanmar tractor with a hammer. It had run hot again and scalded him, so he was ill-tempered and short, which is his most natural state. I don't know if he was working on it or just getting even. "You seen my dog?" I asked. "He's in jail," he said. Bam! Again. In the dog's first month here, he was incarcerated 29 times. Telling him to behave, even after almost 2 years now, is like telling him it is Tuesday. "What," I asked, "did he do now?" "Run the mule," he said. I told him that was not so bad, a dog running one solitary mule. "Run the mule, run the donkeys, run 'em half to death, run 'em round and round the pasture, biting at their legs, run 'em till they went to blowing and bucking and screaming and tried to kick him to death. Don't know where he wanted 'em to go. Don't think he did." Bam! "What else?" I asked, because there was always something else. "Drag part of an old dead deer up to the house. Stunk worse than anything I ever smelt. Laid there chewing on a leg bone by the kitchen window. You can still smell it." He paused to let his contempt gather, like an old creaky train cresting a hill. "Picked a fight with Mama's puppy. Stole the puppy's ball and took it off and buried it. When I fed him, he wouldn't let the puppy eat. Went and laid in the puppy's bowl and growled. Bam! Bam! Bam!" He pointed to a puddle in the middle of the garage floor. "Peed on the tractor. Peed on my truck. Peed on Mama's flowers." The zinnias looked like they had been poisoned. "So Mama told me to lock him up." He set down the hammer and picked up a wrench. He twisted it grimly on a rusted bolt, like he was tightening a noose, and realized he'd left something out. "Eat all the cat food Mama put out. Cats flying everywhere." I laughed, and he shot me a dirty look. He does not even like the cats, which are too well fed to catch mice and have no practical use. How he must loathe my dog to take the sight of a cat. He went back to abusing the tractor, mumbling around a big dip of snuff. I could only make out about every third word, but the gist, I believe, was that I never should have let the dog take root here in the first place. Should have run him off immediately and permanently with a handful of rocks. A pitiful stray is one thing. You can save a gentle stray. But a dog like this, wild for so long, would bring only woe. He didn't say woe, but that was what he meant. Sometimes, when my dog walked too close to him, he spit on his head. Sam owned only obedient, serious dogs, and there is no room in his mind for a dog that cannot work for a living or do what it is told. He grew up in a time when even the best dogs lived at the end of a logging chain and ate from an upside-down hubcap. He dosed their manes with burnt motor oil and dressed their wounds in kerosene. They were throwaway dogs, too, earless, toothless, chewed on, stitched up, and gun-shy. But they loaded themselves into the truck's dog box without being told. trailed a scent across miles and mountains, and stayed on a tree till he kicked them off it. His dogs would swim a river for him. All he had to do was whistle. "You got to train a dog, got to make a mind," he said, making it plain that everything wrong with my dog was my fault. I had tried to train the dog for months, for years, but had miserably failed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.